Everybody, welcome back to The Art of Photography. My name is Ted Forbes. This is another installment in our black and white photography series. Although I will warn you, we're dealing with a lot of color images today, but bear with me, there is a method to my madness. We talked about last time the zone system and Ansel Adams' approach to using a series, dividing your light into a series of zones and really determining what zone range your film is capable of picking up. And then you can manipulate that by varying your development time. So for instance, you would actually expose for the shadows and then you change your development time to make sure the highlights are visible. If the highlights go too far out, they blow out. If the shadows go too dark, they get too dark and you can't see any detail. So how does this apply to digital photography? Well, digital photography is a little bit different because you're dealing with an electronic sensor and there's no chemicals and there's no development time. And so really kind of what you get on that sensor is what you've got. So if your camera's capable of, you know, so much dynamic range, that's kind of where you're stuck. But you can vary that a little bit if you start using some techniques that are known as HDR or high dynamic range photography. Now, I will give you a disclaimer right off the bat. For years, I avoided HDR photography. And the reason is most of the examples that I've seen look really ugly. There's a cartoonish look to it sometimes. There's strange things going on with local contrast and with sharpness and things like that and with localized detail. But within the last year, I thought, you know, well, the concept is there. And the concept is that what you do is you take a series of exposures. So, you know, if you meter an exposure and you decide that this is the best exposure for this scene, but some of the highlights are blowing out because they're still too bright, since we're talking about high contrast, and some of the shadow detail you're still losing because it just, you know, it's not there, you're fixed on that limited range. But what HDR allows you to do is take a series of exposures. So if I take a second picture and I underexpose the whole thing, that brings the highlights down to where they're not blown out anymore. And if I take a third exposure that is overexposed, it brings up the light and the shadows. And so basically what HDR photography does is, or HDR as a technique does, is it uses, you know, if you use Photoshop or there's a number of pieces of software that'll do this, it basically takes the best of those three exposures and puts them together. So it keeps the blown highlights from going too far out, it keeps the shadows from being lost, and it combines them all into an exposure. Now, unfortunately, there's a lot of control in this, and there's a lot of weird things that Photoshop or whatever software you're doing has to do to make this work. I think on, you know, a very base level, in theory, it should work, but you have all these localized differences with contrast and things like that. Now, I'm not going to show you how to shoot HDR images today. We've already shot some, and I want to show you how to process them. In the next couple episodes, we'll talk about how to shoot them. If you kind of already know what you're doing with aperture and shutter speed and things like that, the main thing is shooting HDR images, because you want three identical images except for the exposure. So you need to keep your aperture the same for all three exposures because you don't want your depth of field to change. Otherwise you have blur in some and not in the other. So you need to be able to fix your aperture and manipulate this using shutter speed or even ISO, since that's an option on digital cameras. And we'll get more into that next time. And you also need to shoot with a tripod because you can't have your scene moving. All the images need to be aligned. So this isn't ideal for everything. You wouldn't shoot sports photography using HDR techniques. But anyway, and I know also, I will say this, that I'm not the only one who's had kind of a subjective disinterest in HDR photography, that it's kind of a cult of people that like that as an effect. And what I'm talking about today is not using it as an effect. What we're doing is we're using an HDR technique to achieve a means to an end. And basically what that is evening out our exposure. So the highlights come back a little bit, they're not blown out, or the shadows come back. Now this applies mainly for high contrast situations. If you're shooting indoors or outdoors on a cloudy day and the dynamic range of your scene fits perfectly into your camera, maybe it's a little flat, maybe you need more a brighter highlight or a darker shadow, I don't think HDR is the answer for that. I think it's easier just to use levels or curves adjustments in Photoshop and do it in post-processing. But anyway, come on over to the computer and I want to show you kind of how we can put some of these things together. Okay, so what we're looking at here, we're in Adobe Bridge right now. We're going to be using a couple pieces of software, namely from the Creative Suite from Adobe. There are other ways to do an HDR image. There are other software out there that probably offer you more options. But again, we're really not going for an HDR effect here. We're using HDR as a tool. So I've found that for my use that Adobe Photoshop works fine for this. But what we're looking here, we've got a exposure up here. And this is a night scene that I shot. And more or less, you can see right here that this is what the camera metered as an acceptable exposure. And it is fairly even. The only thing you're going to notice here is back here behind the sculpture, you start losing a lot of detail. These trees have gone to black, and you know, in the with the film equivalent, this is dropped below zone three here, and you can see here in these trees here that the highlights are getting blown out. We're losing a lot of detail because it's gone too bright, and that would, you know, the equivalent would be highlights going above zone seven, you know, with the zone system. And so what we do with HDR is you're going to take a series of exposures, and you can do multiple exposures, doesn't matter how many. The more you have, the more information, you know, Photoshop has to put this together. But what we can see is if I kind of go through these, this next exposure is the same shot and the same aperture setting, but this was underexposed two stops. Okay, so what you can see what happens here is that the highlights back in these trees, we get our detail back, that's fine, and even the highlights on the light on this building, but you can see that we've really lost a lot of shadow detail on here. So what you're starting to see here are the limits of your camera in terms of dynamic range. I've got another example here, and this one is overexposed two stops. Okay, so we took our regular exposure, overexposed to two stops. We get a lot of shadow detail, a lot of detail in the grass is back, the sky is clear, but we blow highlights. And this is the trade-off. This is the trade-off with anything in photography, is finding that exposure. But what we're looking at here is you can really see where the limits are as far as the dynamic range goes on your camera. Now, your eye is capable of a larger dynamic range, but you have limits not only with the camera, but in this case, you're looking at video, so it's a computer screen. And, you know, you have limits for printing on paper, too. So anyway, so what we're going to do is take each one of these three exposures here, and we're going to merge these using the HDR technique here. So what we're going to do is I'm going to select all three images, and the easiest way, you could go into Photoshop and do it from in there, too, but I like to do it from Bridge. I'm going to go up under the top, under the Tools menu, and I'm going to go down here to Photoshop. In the little flyout window, there is a Merge to HDR Pro sample here. This saves me from having to go find these images from the Finder. So anyway, so I'm going to go ahead and select that. And what's going to happen is it's going to open Photoshop, and it's going to start running some algorithms to analyze these images and see where they are. This does take a while, so depending on how fast your computer is or how slow your computer is, you're going to see a big difference here in your processing power. So if you have a really slow computer, this might be a good time to you know, make phone calls or get a cup of coffee or whatever you got to do. Okay, so we are in this preview screen here, and I'm going to show you how this works. What it does is right off the bat, it tries to determine an even exposure. Okay, so what it does is it brings up the shadows and brings down the highlights. And you can see in this image now that we don't have any shadows, or excuse me, any highlights that are blowing out. We still retain detail back in this church here and in this building. And we have pretty even tonal range throughout the shadow areas, the sky, which had gone to black earlier, and then back here in the grass and these trees back here. The problem with this image right off the bat is that it looks like an HDR image, and this is what I think, this is kind of what separates the men from the boys, so to speak, for, you know, people who know what they're doing. I don't prefer HDR to be in effect, like I've said a billion times already, but anyway, let's look at what some of these sliders do over here, and we're going to find ways to get this image looking a little better, a little more like what we want it to. Okay, you have a series of presets up here, and it is determined, that's why it's under custom by default, it's determined kind of what it should do as far as evening the exposure out across these three images. There are a series of presets in here. There's some monochromatic, photorealistic. I really, you know, I'm not a big preset guy anyway. This is assuming that all images, you know, are pretty much the same response, and they're not, and you really start to get the cartoon effects with those. But what I would rather do is let's look at what each one of these options gives us. The first thing you see up here is a little tick box that says remove ghosts. And this is kind of important, and you don't see a whole lot of it in this picture, but there was traffic moving on the street back here when I took this, and you can kind of see this flag over here was blowing in the wind. And when I select remove ghosts, what it's going to do is it's going to analyze, and it's going to pick one of the images that seems to have the most even exposure, and you can see there it just popped. And it wasn't a dramatic difference in this, but it keeps you from having that ghosting effect. So if you were shooting people or something that's moving, you know, that's one way you can kind of, you know, bring that back to reality, as far as, you know, not having double exposures or ghosted exposures. The first thing up here, we're going to leave this in 16-bit mode and local adaptation. This is going to give you the most control over what you're doing here. The first option here is called Edge Glow, and this is, I kind of wish this wouldn't be first, because what this does is it basically determines, you know, contrast is determined by the difference between light areas and dark areas and how strong that is. So you're going to have a sharper image. That's the effect that you see, and it's a little beyond the scope of what we're talking about here. But when I bring the strength way up on here, you can see that what it does is it sharpens the image in a weird way. It brings a lot of this glow back. And again, this is not a look that I like. So I usually leave these down and play with them only if they're needed, which is kind of why it's kind of weird that Edge Glow appears first in the set of options, because people start tweaking that and that feel like that's, you know, the look they're going for. Under tone and detail, this one's more important here. Under gamma, if I change the gamma, if I bring this slider to the left, it's going to bring the gamma down. But what it does is it increases the contrast a little bit. So let's go extreme with this. I'll bring it all the way down. You can see that it kind of went back to what we were trying to avoid, where it blew out highlights and darkened the shadows too much. So let's leave the gamma kind of set here in the middle, but we can get rid of a little bit of that HDR look to it that's real flat by just bringing that down a little bit. Exposure, this more or less, you shouldn't have to deal with this if you had a correct exposure to begin with, but the exposure basically lightens or darkens the scene. It just brings up the overall exposure. So let's go back to zero on that. For detail, and this is an important one too, the detail, basically this is going to bring out more sharpness and more edge definition. But when I bring this up, you can see, let's go extreme with this. This is another really bad HDR look. In fact, let's crank it up so you can see just how bad this gets. What it does is it tries to sharpen a lot of the localized contrast here, like you can see it real well in the grass and, you know, in our glow in here in these lights and these trees in front of the church and even the bricks in the church. But the problem is this gets so surreal looking that, again, we have that effect. So be careful with the detail. Also, consequently, if you go the other way with this slider, it gives you the kind of this weird, soft, pastel blur, which starts making your photo look like a painting. And that's not what we're going for with this technique. What we're trying to do is just even out exposure. So again, you know, with great power comes great responsibility. And unfortunately, I think sometimes people get a little carried away. So we're going to go back down to about 26 or so with this and leave that alone. Now, these two sliders are pretty important, the shadow and the highlight. And this is what can bring back your shadows a little bit if you need more or darken them in our case here, because I actually think they're a little too bright. So if I bring up the shadow, you can see that it actually flattened out the shadow areas. If I bring this down, and it's very subtle, there it darkened them, and that looks a little more realistic. We don't need quite so much detail in the grass and the trees back there. And the same with the highlights. If I bring that way up, you're going to start blowing your highlights again. Of course, this is localized, so it's a lot more subtle. You can see it in the trees down there. But if we bring this down, it darkens them, and we get a lot of detail back in the trees. It's a little too much. I'm going to go back and leave this. Let's go back to zero on that. And then finally, you have vibrance and saturation, and these just deal with the color. We're doing this as kind of a series of black and white images, so, you know, I'm not going to mess with that too much right now. I know that we're not dealing with black and white, but, you know, digital cameras, this one shot color, so that's what we're working with. Okay, now it's still a little flat, and we can work with that once we get into Photoshop, but I'm going to go ahead and say okay. And again, what it's going to do is it's going to take some time here to create the file, because it's going to run its algorithm based on the settings that we just gave it. And we're going to kind of even things out and, you know, determine the final exposure here. So what it's doing is it's actually merging all three of these images that were taken at different exposures into one image. And, you know, like I said, if your computer's slow, mine's middle of the road, but I am doing a screen recording at the same time, so it's probably going to take a minute. So I'm going to do a fancy edit here, and we'll come back once it's done. All right, so we are done creating our HDR image here. Now, there is still a little bit of an HDR look to this, and simply because we're trying to force a technology that's fairly new of combining these three exposures and making the image do something it doesn't want to do, and bringing these exposures into something that looks realistic to our eye. It's still just a little bit flat for my taste, and I know I'm being ultra picky. So what I would do probably is add a curves layer in here, and I go ahead and bring up the highlights just a little bit, and we're going to do an S-curve, which basically creates a little bit of contrast. We're going to bring down the shadows, and we more or less, we got a good image here. Now, you may think that, well, why do we go all of that trouble? It doesn't look much different than it should have begun. You know, I don't see the effect. Again, we're not going for an effect here. We're just going for an even look to things. And let me see, I think now would be a good time. Let's compare it with the original image. Let's go back to Bridge, and I'm just going to open the original image in Photoshop so you can see the two side by side. And you can see here's the original image, and again, shadows are lost, highlights are blown a little bit. It did an okay job, but now let's look at this HDR image that we did. It evened things out. And this is really important because this is part of this black and white series, and once we go start performing, there's a number of options you have for getting a black and white image, with a digital photograph that was taken with color. In fact, you have a lot of really nice versatile options, but this makes sure that, you know, your shadows are retained and that your highlights are retained and that we have a nice even exposure across the board and you have everything visible that you need. The only area that, you know, and again, I could have thought about this when I shot it, but this large D, this logo on the side of this building, that does start to glow and blow out a little bit. And you can see that it actually did that pretty seriously in the original image. And so probably I would need a little bit wider exposure than two stops to try to tame that down a little bit. But for the most part, this image is okay. You know, I think with especially night pictures, it's okay to have things blown out now and then. Just, you know, it's almost unavoidable because you have such a wide contrast range. Let me close this image down here just a second. And so you can see I have another folder of images. And these are some that I did before we actually started rolling the tape here. But you can see here, this is a really extreme example. This is a night photo, and this is actually a sign that is displayed in front of an art museum. And you can see that the sign is lit, and so the camera tried to determine an exposure the best it could do. The sign does blow out just a little bit. It treated that as a major part of the exposure, which it should have. But you can see that the rest, I mean, just went to dark on the outsides. Now, I did a two-stop over and under exposure on this and did an HDR image, and you can see that you can, in fact, bring a lot of that detail back. Now, a while back, and by a while back, I mean probably over a year ago, we talked about a technique where you can bring back some of the shadow areas by using the shadows highlights adjustment. And you could do that on this, but it's so dark that it just gets really noisy and it just does not work. So I think this is a case where using an HDR technique is about the best way to go. And here's another one. This was a little bit less of an extreme example. Slightly overcast day. I did get a little break in the clouds. Here's a water tower that I photographed. And you can see that you're really starting to lose shadow detail in the bowl of the water tower down here. It goes below zone 3 and you just lose your detail and it becomes just a dark shadow. And then also clouds can become difficult too. It did a fairly good job of exposing this, but you do lose some detail up here. They didn't really get blown out, but when you do an HDR example of this, you know, I did open up some of the shadows in the bowl of the water tower here, and then we have some blowing out of the highlights in the clouds, but again, a wider exposure would probably fix some of that. So anyway, once again, this has more or less been HDR techniques, and I think the important thing to do is, you know, there's a whole school of photographers right now that are using HDR for the effect or the look, and it's getting into dangerous territory because it takes on such an unphotographic look to it. It gets a cartoon look to it, or sometimes it just looks bad. And that's important to realize. You also see people doing over and under exposures with HDR when the dynamic range is fully capable of being captured on the digital camera. So it just does weird things to the photo. And so, you know, just to reiterate what we're talking about here, and we're going to get back into black and white photography in the next episode, but what we're looking at is just making sure that we have represented all the tones we need in our photograph. I think this is the most extreme example here because we just have complete darkness and a blown out sign. So, you know, the dynamic range of the camera was not able to capture everything in that scene. You could shoot raw in here and bring back a little bit, but even then, I think the combining exposures is going to be your best bet. The key to this is doing it in a subtle way that does not overpower the image and, you know, have the cartoon effect. Okay, so we took a look at how to merge a series of exposures into an HDR photograph or a high dynamic range photo. Now, I think it's also important to say once again that there are a series of effects that you can get out of this, and there's really a whole cult of people who really like those, you know, kind of distorted, surreal, almost cartoony looks to things. And I'm not saying that to insult anybody. I'm just saying that it's not my taste, and what I'm showing you here is not how to do that. What I'm showing you here is the intention of making an HDR image where you're basically making sure you've got all your shadows condensed and all your highlights from blowing out. Just the nature of this, because your eye sees a much wider dynamic range than even film or digital can put together, if you start compressing too much, it will look unrealistic because it's not realistic. So what you're trying to do is find a subtle happy medium there that allows you to bring back shadows and bring back highlights if it is a problem that they're getting blown out. I also want to note that there are people that will do this to scenes, and I said this a minute ago, that, you know, maybe an overcast day or they're shooting indoors doing portraits, something where they really have all the dynamic range they need. Nothing's getting blown out or going too dark. In fact, it may be too narrow and it's a little muddy. In that case, what I would rather do myself to create more contrast is to just take a single image and make a layers adjustment, like a curves layer or a levels layer, and, you know, doing it that way. HDR is designed for bringing things that are outside of the scope of the camera into the picture, and so that's really a better way to go. And you see people that do that with that too, and they get this weird localized contrast and stuff. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's just not a realistic look, and it's not what we're talking about here today. So I just want to make that clear. The second thing you're probably wondering is, I thought this was a series on black and white, and we sat here and looked at color images. Well, that's what we're going to do next. You have actually a lot of really cool options for converting a digital image to from color to black and white. But first things first, if your exposure is not on, or if you have highlights that are blown or shadows that are lost, you can't get them back. So that's why I wanted to cover this today. So that's a technique I would do to get just the basic picture down first. And next time we're going to talk about some conversion options you have for black and white. We're also going to come back to film too, and it's really weird kind of talking about the two different, you know, sides of the house as far as digital goes and film goes, because they really are two different things, and I don't mean to get too out of order, but I kind of think that if you understand one and shoot the other, or vice versa, if you're a film shooter to understand the digital side or a digital shooter to understand the film side, it makes a lot more sense in what we're all going for in the overall picture. So anyway, that's why I'm kind of covering these kind of back and forth, so to speak. So anyway, once again, this has been The Art of Photography. Join us online on the Flickr group if you'd like. The URL for that is flickr.com/groups/art of photography, and be sure to follow us on Twitter. You can follow me, my handle is @TedForbes, or you could follow the show if you just want show updates, and that handle is @AOP_podcast. So once again, this has been The Art of Photography, and thank you for watching.